Hey everyone, this is Caroline Friday, Neighborhood Bible Study. We're continuing our study in Matthew. We're in chapter 8. You know, I want to say a word about the Supreme Court's decision. The Supreme Court just made their decision 2 days ago regarding the redefinition of marriage, requiring that all states, all 50 states, acknowledge same-sex marriage. And I have a lot of Christian friends who are mourning and lamenting and viewing this as a sign of the end of the world. And my message to all my Christian friends is this is not the end of the world. This is very much in line with the way the world should operate. The world is steeped in sin. The world is blind. The world is in darkness. They don't know the light. They don't know Jesus Christ. And so this is an excellent opportunity for us Christians to share the love of Jesus Christ, to shed light on the truth, and to not view this as a failure, not to view this as a doom and gloom that America is lost and America is ready to descend into the depths of hell or anything like that, but view it as a wonderful opportunity for us to share the gospel and to share the love of Jesus Christ. And I am forcing myself to view this as an exciting time to share that love and to share that truth, and to do it on YouTube, to do it on video, to do it through books and through teachings and Bible studies. And I am convinced that there are people out there who are trapped in the lifestyle of the homosexual lifestyle that don't like it. I'm not convinced, as the world would like us to believe, that everyone in that lifestyle is happy and that they're content. I believe there are many who are trapped. They've been lied to. They've been told, this is the way you've been born. You have no choice. This is how you have to be, and suck it up and learn to love it. I believe there are many who would love to hear the truth and would love to hear from the church there's another option, and the option is Jesus Christ. I don't care what someone's feelings are, what their inclinations are. Jesus Christ can make all things new. And maybe if the church began to share that truth a little more boldly, see, I'm putting the pressure back on the church and not pointing the finger at the world, but if we can maybe share truth a little bit more boldly than we've done, then perhaps people will see the truth and be drawn to it. You know, if it's tough to step out with boldness and declare that this Bible is the inerrant word of God. There are many who want to throw stones. I have friends who are in the gay lifestyle, and I love them, but they're very quick to throw stones, and I'm going to love them. I'm not going to lash back. But if there's one person out there, only one person, who's trapped in that lifestyle, and I say trapped because they do feel trapped, and if they get the truth and they get born again, and Jesus delivers them from that lifestyle and brings them into a place of wholeness and fullness and the best that God has for them, then that is a wonderful thing. So we operate in love. We don't wag the finger. What we do is we hold up Jesus Christ. He is the answer. He has been my salvation, and He has helped me come out from deception. I feel like I come out from one deception to another deception. Where all of us are climbing our way out of a lot of false teaching and a lot of wrong things we've been taught in the world. And we're coming to a fuller revelation of this gospel of grace. It's the same gospel that the Apostle Paul and all the apostles of old, they received this gospel and they believed it. They stood firm. Unfortunately, over a period of 2,000 years, there's been some perversion and some mixture of law that's crept in there, and of course, worldly things. So anyway, I just wanted to give an encouragement to my Christian brethren out there to stand firm and view this as a time of opportunity. Maybe God has put a ministry desire on your heart and you haven't done it and you felt like the timing was not right. Maybe now is the time. Maybe now is the time for a lot of us to step out with a greater boldness than we've ever done before. So I would view this as an opportunity, not a failure. And don't view this as a time to shrink back and just say, well, Jesus is coming back in a couple of years and rapture us out of here, and this earth world can just go to hell in a handbasket. I don't believe that that's right. Even if Jesus were to come back in a couple of years, which I don't believe that's going to happen, but even if he did, he'd want you out there being bold. He wouldn't want you shrinking back and just giving up and saying, well, you know, what can I do about it? No, he'd want you to step out in faith and to do all the things he'd called you to do. So that, I hope that's an encouragement. I've had to stir myself up because I've been tempted to kind of shrink down into depression about it. But the Lord has told me to view it as an opportunity and to get excited. You know, we got a lot of work to do. There's a lot of people out there who need to hear the gospel, not religion. They don't need religion or denominationalism. They need the gospel. What is the gospel? The gospel is God the Father is not mad at you anymore. He wants you to be his child. You received Jesus Christ and everything that was done on the cross. You received the fact that he died for you. He took all sin. He fulfilled the law. He took the curse away. And if you can receive that, he overcame death, hell, and the grave. And if you can receive that and give yourself over to him and declare him as your Lord, he will cause you to be reborn as a child of God. He will pour his spirit into you and write his laws on your heart. You will become a new creation. He will show you what to do. You will begin a wonderful walk with the Lord. It's a walk into truth. But if you resist and you stand firm and you say, nope, I know what's true, I know what's right, and I believe God condones it, and I'm just going to believe what I believe, then you're deceived. You are deceived. And why would you be deceived? Why would you, when the truth has been given to you and it's free? All you have to do is receive it as a gift. Why would you reject the truth? You know, I want to know the truth. I want to dig in and find out all the truth about God. That's just me. Some people don't want to know the truth. I don't understand that. But the truth is available. It's free. It's wonderful. It will change lives. And it will restore the years that the locusts have eaten. It can change your physical body. We saw that in the Old Covenant with Sarah and Abraham. They were able to have a baby at the age of 99. I believe that their bodies were restored to the point where they could conceive and have a baby, carry it to full term, and raise it. It takes a lot of energy to raise a child. So changes can be made. I believe that personalities and soul desires can be changed. This gospel can change desires, even desires of the flesh. I've had that happen to me, and other people have had it happen to them as well. The Apostle Paul, classic example, he was on a murderous streak, trying to kill as many Christians as possible to stop the movement. One encounter with Jesus, one encounter, and he was miraculously changed. Miraculously changed. His eyes were opened, he saw the truth, and he couldn't go back. He was a new person. Even the believers in Jerusalem were shocked. They couldn't believe that someone could change that dramatically. But he did. He changed dramatically. And he is the one who Jesus gave this gospel of grace to. It was the Apostle Paul. He got this gospel of grace and he was charged to go to the Gentiles, of whom I am. I am a Gentile. And he was charged to go to the Gentile world and spread the gospel. Praise God for that. Praise God that we can become new creations in Christ Jesus. We don't have to be held down by our past or held down by our fleshly desires. You know, you're not defined by your sexual proclivity. You are not defined by your gender or your nationality. That's not how God defined you. He defined you, are you my child? If you're in Christ Jesus, you're his child. There's neither male nor female, Jew nor Greek, slave nor free. All are one in Christ Jesus. So reject being defined by your nationality, by your race, by your gender, by your sexual proclivity. You are a child of God. Allow the Holy Spirit to work through you and change you. Ask the Heavenly Father to reveal truth to you, and He will do so. Okay, we're going to continue on in Matthew, and we're going to look at the second healing that's in Matthew. This healing is the healing of a Gentile, the centurion's servant. Verse 5 says, "And when Jesus was entered into Capernaum, there came unto him a centurion beseeching him, and saying, Lord, my servant lieth at home, sick of the palsy, grievously tormented. And Jesus said unto him, I will come and heal him. The centurion answered and said, Lord, I am not worthy that thou shouldest come under my roof, but speak the word only, and my servant shall be healed. For I am a man under authority, having soldiers under me, and I say to this man, go, and he goeth, and to another, come, and he cometh, and to my servant, do this, and he doeth it. When Jesus heard it, he marveled, and said to them that followed, Verily I say unto you, I have not found so great faith, no, not in Israel. And I say unto you, that many shall come from the east and west, and shall sit down with Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob in the kingdom of heaven. But the children of the kingdom shall be cast out into outer darkness. There shall be weeping and gnashing of teeth. And Jesus said unto the centurion, Go thy way, as thou hast believed, so it be done unto thee. And his servant was healed in the selfsame hour. This is a Gentile Roman soldier, a pagan, who is in the command of many Roman soldiers. Isn't it interesting that he is very aware of Jesus Christ as being a man of authority? What's so interesting about this Gentile man is that he understands rulership, not only authority, but rulership. He's under the command of the Caesar, and so he understands how that operates. But he has noticed Jesus Christ, and he notices that Jesus acts like someone in authority as a ruler, and he treats Jesus as a ruler. He's treating Jesus as Messiah. That's the way that Israel should have treated him. Instead of the rulers of Israel trying to trick Jesus and trying to catch him in saying something wrong and judging. Basically, they were judging him and not treating him with respect. This pagan Roman centurion is treating Jesus Christ as Messiah, as a king. And he's saying, I know that you can take authority over these demons that are grievously tormenting my beloved servant. And I know that I am not worthy of you coming to my house because I'm a Gentile. All you have to do is say the word. Just say the word and it will be done. This demon will leave. Just as I speak to my soldiers and I tell them to go here and there and they do it. They're people under command. They just do it. They don't question it. I know the same will be true for this demon that's afflicting my servant. Well, I believe that he witnessed Jesus healing people and casting out demons, and he did it with a word. I believe Jesus went about and he just said, out, get out. There was no great fanfare. It was just get out, be healed. Touching someone and the sickness would leave. A person that had great authority like a king. And this Roman centurion sees that, recognizes it, and treats Jesus with the respect. He treats him as Lord. And the faith that he has in the authority of Jesus, the faith that Jesus could speak the word, perhaps being a mile away, he doesn't even have to come to his house. He could just speak the word right there where he's standing. And that authority would be so powerful that the very word that came from Jesus' mouth would do the deed instantly. You know, that's a picture of the New Testament church. You know, I can pray for someone in China right this minute. I can pray for someone in China, and that prayer is as effective and powerful as if I was standing right there by their bedside holding their hand. Now the Lord may want me to be by the bedside holding the hand, but the authority and the power of God is as effective miles and miles away as it is right there by someone's side. The power of Jesus Christ is a spiritual power, and there are no time limits and there's no distance in the Spirit. This man recognized it. He recognized it and he vocalized it verbally out in the open in front of everyone, in front of these Jewish disciples who didn't see it. He saw something they didn't see. He recognized a truth that they had not yet recognized. See, he's not steeped in the law, in the Jewish law. He's a pagan. You know, sometimes people who have come out of agnostic, atheist backgrounds have an easier time accepting this gospel of grace and accepting the truth that Jesus heals. A lot of times, religious denominational people who have been so ingrained with religion, they just have a real hard time believing things of the Spirit. They're afraid of it. They're resistant to it. And I'd much rather, to be honest, I'd much rather come from an agnostic atheist background and receive this than from a quote-unquote mainline denomination where I have great confidence in my many church goings and many Sunday school outings and all the things that denominational people take pride in. Those things won't get you anywhere. Nowhere. It won't get you any greater insight, any greater revelation. You're not going to walk in the power of the Spirit. You're just going to be puffed up in your pride, in your religion. Well, this centurion man was the antithesis of the puffed up, proud Israelite who was so proud of his lineal heritage and so proud of his good deeds and all the law keeping and even walking side by side with Jesus. He saw the power and the authority. He understood the power of the spoken word with that authority, and he asked for it openly, and he got it instantaneously. And Jesus said to his disciples, he turned to his disciples, and he said, "Verily I say unto you, truly I say unto you, I have not found so great faith, no, not in Israel." The greatest faith that he had seen so far, and this was a time when the multitudes were following him, multitudes of people were thronging about him, and he had his Jewish disciples, and he said, "I have not seen so great faith as I have seen in this man right here." And he turned to the centurion and he said, "Go thy way, as thou hast believed, so be it done unto thee." As thou hast believed. You know, a lot of times we may ask, why isn't God doing X, Y, and Z for us? Why aren't we getting healed? In our pride, we may say, well, I have faith. I believe. I'm going to church. I'm doing this. I prayed. I asked. Well, do you really believe? Do you really, truly believe? Maybe you do. And maybe you just need to hold firm and wait for the healing to come. It's coming. Or maybe you don't really believe. Maybe you have a lot of doubts. And you don't really know if God truly loves you. You don't really know if you've been forgiven for all of your sins. And see, that's a problem. Because you've taken the old wine from the old covenant and you've mixed it in with the new wine. And now you've got this mixture that just brings death. And we're going to talk about that later. But we need to make sure that we are drinking the pure gospel wine, the new wine of the new covenant. We have to believe that all of our sins have been forgiven. That God is not counting our sins against us. That he loves us. He does not see fault in us. And we have to accept that. And it may take a lot of time just to purge our mind of wrong thinking. But this man knew the authority. He asked for it, he got it. His servant was healed. And Jesus gives a warning to his disciples. This is another warning, another prophetic warning of 70 AD. And he says to his followers, many shall come from the east and the west and shall sit down with Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob in the kingdom of heaven. But the children of the kingdom shall be cast out into outer darkness, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. That happened in 70 AD. Between 30 AD, which was the date of the crucifixion, and 70 AD was 40 years, which is the time period for a generation. We know that the Israelites were in the wilderness for 40 years. That's God's time clock for a generation. In that 40-year period, Jesus' followers were frantically preaching the gospel to that area, to the known world, to all of Judea, Jerusalem, and Samaria, and wherever the Holy Spirit led them, preaching this gospel, sharing the good news, because a judgment was coming. The old covenant system, the sacrificial temple system, was going to be judged. And that happened in 70 AD. On the day of Passover, 70 AD, the temple was destroyed. There was a great siege that basically lasted a long time, 3.5 years of persecution. There was a great tribulation, and we're going to talk about that later. But this is a prophecy that Jesus is giving, a warning that there would be many. There would be many who would believe this gospel during that time period, during that 40-year period. There would be many who would come to believe, and they would partake of this kingdom that was being ushered in, one of whom was the centurion and his family. There were going to be Gentile people who were going to come into this kingdom, but the Jewish people who rejected and refused to believe, they were going to be cast out, they were going to be destroyed. And we know from Josephus and a lot of the historians during that time that many, many Jewish people died. An unimaginable horror occurred when the city fell and the temple. And so they did not heed this warning. They wanted to stand firm and believe that the temple system was the way that God was going to deliver them. And he did deliver them through the temple system, through Jesus Christ, the fulfillment of the temple system. See, you have to look at things God's way. If you look at things through your eyes, through your natural way, and through your mind, the way you think things should be, you're going to suffer. But if you look at things through spiritual eyes, the way God says, then amazing truth comes your way, and you get delivered. And wonderful things happen. So I love the story. I love how we see a Jewish healing, a leprous man, and then we see a Gentile healing of the centurion. You see a great difference in the way the healing was asked. There was a request, and you see a great difference in the way the healing was given. And you see a prophecy that the kingdom will be given to the Gentiles. The leprous man, when he went to the temple to show himself to the priest, and when they would do their laborious Mosaic ceremony to declare him clean, and we talked about that last time. Historically, there's no documentation that anyone had been healed of leprosy through the temple system. So when they saw that leprous man was healed, they should have immediately jumped for joy, knowing Messiah had come. But they didn't. They continued to reject him. So, and again, all of us who are born again, we have a hard time understanding that. But it is what it is. And we just have to keep praying for people who are blind and keep loving them and keep praying that the Heavenly Father will open their eyes. Let's go look at the next little bit here. We're going to look at Peter's mother-in-law, verse 14. And when Jesus was coming to Peter's house, he saw his wife's mother laid and sick of a fever. And he touched her hand, and the fever left her, and she arose and ministered unto them. When the evening was come, they brought unto him many that were possessed with devils, and he cast out the spirits with his word, and healed all that were sick. All were healed, that it might be fulfilled which was spoken by Isaiah the prophet, saying, himself took our infirmities and bare our sicknesses. Okay, so the writer is telling us that this event, when he goes into Peter's house, heals his mother-in-law, people brought their sick, demon-possessed friends and relatives to him. And he healed all of them. All of them who were possessed by demonic spirits were delivered. And all, A-L-L, who were sick were healed. This, he says, the writer says, fulfilled the prophecy of Isaiah 53. So we have to go to Isaiah 53, which we're going to look at real quick. I'm going to start reading from Isaiah 53, verse 1. Who has believed our report? And to whom is the arm of the Lord revealed? For he shall grow up before him as a tender plant, and as a root out of a dry ground. He hath no form nor comeliness, and when we shall see him, there is no beauty that we should desire him. He is despised and rejected of men, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief. And we hid, as it were, our faces from him. He was despised, and we esteemed him not. Surely he has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows, yet we did esteem him stricken, smitten of God, and afflicted. For he was wounded for our transgressions, he was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him, and with his stripes we are healed. All we like sheep have gone astray, we have turned every one to his own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. He was oppressed and he was afflicted, yet he opened not his mouth. He is brought as a lamb to the slaughter, and as a sheep before her shearers is dumb, so he opened not his mouth. He was taken from prison and from judgment, and who shall declare his generation? For he was cut off out of the land of the living, for the transgression of my people was he stricken. And he made his grave with the wicked and with the rich in his death, because he had done no violence, neither was there any deceit in his mouth. Yet it pleased the Lord to bruise him. He hath put him to grief. When thou shalt make his soul an offering for sin, he shall see his seed. He shall prolong his days, and the pleasure of the Lord shall prosper in his hand. He shall see of the travail of his soul, and shall be satisfied. By his knowledge shall my righteous servant justify many, for he shall bear their iniquities. Therefore will I divide him a portion with the great, and he shall divide the spoil with the strong, because he has poured out his soul unto death, and he was numbered with the transgressors, and he bare the sin of many, and made intercession for the transgressors. Now this is a prophecy that Isaiah gave of the Messiah. Those who are on the other side of the cross, those of us who are born again, when we see Jesus Christ in this so perfectly, he grew up as a tender shoot. He grew up as a normal Jewish boy. I do not believe these scriptures are saying that he was an ugly Jewish boy. It says there was no beauty in which we could esteem him. I think what that means is there was nothing unusual or significant about him that would make people point him out as a young Jewish boy and say, here is Messiah. He was a normal Jewish boy. He grew in favor with God and man. While he was on the cross, while he was hanging on the cross, his likeness was so disfigured. And I think that was Isaiah 52. Yes, he says, behold, my servant shall deal prudently. He shall be exalted and extolled and be very high. As many were astonished at thee, his visage was so marred more than any man, and his form more than the sons of men. So shall he sprinkle many nations. The kings shall shut their mouths at him, for that which had not been told them shall they see, and that which they had not heard shall they consider. So that's a prophecy right before there at the end of 52 that says he was so marred and so disfigured that people had to turn away, and we know that did happen. He was so marred and disfigured after the Roman beating and all the horrible things they did to him. But the other thing that Isaiah tells us, that he has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows. Now, all my life, I believed that word was griefs. But when I went and looked at the original language, the original Hebrew, do you know what word that is? Sickness. Why have the translators translated that word as griefs? Why? It is sickness. He carried all of our sicknesses and all of our diseases, and by his stripes we are healed. I often wondered, why did Jesus have to be beaten so horribly in order to take our sins? The shedding of blood is required for sin. Death is required. He could have easily had his throat cut, perhaps, and shed his blood. That's how they killed the Passover lamb. They cut its throat and drained out the blood and all that. But that's not how Jesus died. He died a long, suffering, gruesome death that started out with a terrible beating that would have killed a lot of people. My understanding is the Roman beatings was not a Jewish beating. It was a Roman beating. It was so horrible that many would die just from that. Look at the Passion of the Christ and you'll get an idea. No, he was taking our sicknesses and our diseases. They were being put on him. And the Apostle Paul explains that in Galatians 3. That he took the curse. He became the curse of the law. And he became the curse so that the blessing of Abraham would come upon us. And so the writer of Matthew in chapter 8 is telling us that by healing all those people in Peter's house, that was a fulfillment of Isaiah 53. All sickness, all disease, healed by Jesus Christ by his stripes. When he went to the cross, he took all sickness, all disease. You know, if it weren't for the internet and the interlinear Bible where you can get the original language, I would have never known that. I often used to say, why is it that Isaiah 53 says griefs and sorrows and Matthew says sickness? Why is that? Why is there a discrepancy there? Well, the original language in the Hebrew, it says sickness. Now, isn't that interesting? Now, that takes a renewal of the mind. Jesus bore all sickness and all disease? Well, if that's the case, why are there so many sick people? That's a really good question. Why are there so many sick people in the body of Christ? Well, maybe they've been told that Jesus did not bear their sicknesses and their diseases. He bore their griefs and their sorrows. But he did not bear their sicknesses and their diseases. It may be the Father's will that you be sick because he wants to teach you something. You will not find that in Scripture. We've talked about that before. You will not find that in Scripture. The Holy Spirit is the teacher. He teaches us, he leads us, and he guides us. Jesus bore all of our sicknesses and all of our diseases. He wants us to learn how to take authority over sickness and disease, just like that centurion knew that Jesus had authority over sickness and disease. Do you think that a modern day pastor could convince that centurion, if he was go back in time and convince that centurion, that God might want his servant sick? That it may not be his will for that servant to be healed? Absolutely not. You would not get that centurion to believe that. He knew that it was his will, and all he had to do was say the word. Say the word, and it will be done. Because Jesus had authority over all sickness and all disease. And you know, he's given us that authority. We're part of the body of Christ. He's given us that authority over sickness and disease to speak the word. and to pray and declare and to do everything that the Holy Spirit and the Heavenly Father has told us to do about any sickness and disease that may be in our bodies or may be afflicting our children. You know, I have a story to tell. My daughter, she suffered from a very terrible sickness just a year ago. And I was on my knees in desperation. I heard the Holy Spirit say, "Why don't you get up and believe the way you have been teaching for the past 10 years and believe you have authority over this?" And you know, my husband and I took authority, and the doctor came in the room about 5-10 minutes later. He said, "I know what it is. Here's how we're going to treat it, and she's going to be fine." I said, "Praise the Lord." That's how we have to believe. So I'm running out of time. Meditate on these scriptures. We're going to talk about it next time. I know this is touchy area, but look at scripture. Believe. Allow the Holy Spirit to lead you and guide you into all truth. I'll see you next time. Have a blessed day.